We founded a company called Legacy Retail Solutions, and we are a direct supplier to Walmart and Sam's Club on our own business. And we also do strategic advisory. And so we help companies start to address, you know, how do they handle sales, how do they handle replenishment and analytics to a number of companies, to a number of retailers around the globe. Lastly, as we started developing our e-commerce business, we started looking for a few solutions, and we really couldn't find anything that met our needs. And so last year we founded a company, or actually a year ago, December, we founded a company, a brand called Ubiquity, that is really about solving those issues. So enough of that. So our job here today is to try to take an opportunity to get a little bit up out of the forest, to quit bumping around the trees and, you know, trying to solve this one problem or that one problem, and get a look, get up above that tree line and see the horizon. And we believe that there's a big point of inflection that is coming in an already volatile market that is one that all of us as e-commerce professionals have got to start to consider and infuse into our discussions about corporate strategy and investment and how we're going to develop. So that's what we really want to talk about today, JD.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, let's before we get into the past, present, and the future, let's get our brains working. We're not going to do the Walmart cheer. I know we are in Bentonville, but we're going to bypass that.
Sorry to disappoint y'all.
But I would like for us to do a little Q&A, and we would love some audience participation. We went and combed.
We have prizes, high value prizes.
We got wonderful prizes. We went and combed the Walmart shelves last night. This is probably the most exciting new item out there, so you're going to be very privileged to have this, and so please make sure you chime in. But with that, we'll just go to the first question here, and we'll give you guys an example of how this works, and then you guys kind of pick it up, right? So, hey, Clint, do you have any idea what is the size of the total global retail trade value?
JD, I can't even begin to comprehend that. Couldn't be more than $10
trillion. $22.6 trillion. But it's still growing, right? It is growing.
It is growing. Okay. All right, so there's four more questions.
Hey, Clint, I'm gonna come out here, and I'm going to look for some audience participation
okay.
as we start going here now.
Awesome. So, JD, as we think about e-commerce, can you tell us a little bit about, or does anybody here know the size of total e-commerce globally on a GMV basis?
Hold on, Clint. Acronyms. We all know we've been around Walmart. They all break down the acronyms. So what is GMV? I mean, did you just make that up? Does anybody got any help? Anybody know what GMV stands for?
I heard somebody. Gross merchandise value. Close, very close. And so it's what we would think of in brick and mortar. It's the total value of the sales. But in e-commerce, companies mark their sales in different ways, particularly companies that are doing third-party marketplaces might only show the value of their trading profit on it rather than the total value of that product. So that's what we're talking about there.
Well, so before you go there, what do you think that number looks like? Any idea? We know that the total global retail is $22.6 trillion.
Any we can take a percentage.
What e-commerce? Yeah, we can start with a percentage. Keep it easy. It's early. Anyone? Bueller?
6%.
6%. A little higher than that. Close. 18. A little bit lower. Very close. Who said 10? There you go. She's at our table, but we promised we didn't share the information with her. Great job. Here you go. But 25% growth.
It's growing like
that's a. It is absolutely growing like a weed. That's a gigantic number, Clint.
Okay, so does anyone know what the largest e-commerce market around the world is?
Geographic or country?
Geographic. Absolutely.
Studied up.
We got it.
Good job. We'll tell everybody what these are later because then you're dying to know.
Absolutely. China's the largest, doing almost half of the total e-commerce business around the world. Does anyone know the number one site for product research?
Amazon.
Absolutely. To drill that down, does anyone know how many first people go to Amazon first as their point of research? How much?
83%.
Those are good numbers. to go there first, to type in Amazon.com into the browser before you go anywhere else, 52%. A lot of the numbers I think people were relating to, 72% using it as part of their research, a key element in their product research.
That just speaks to the impact that Amazon has, right?
Absolutely. Absolutely. I gave the answer away.
Good job. Great. So what is the largest retail day in the history? And some, it's arguable, maybe the largest day ever in retail, not just e-commerce. But 2017 was Singles Day at $25 billion in sales in a 24-hour period. It's remarkable.
Huge number. Huge number. Does anybody know, so just to put a question on it, does anybody know what retailer Singles Day belongs to? Very good, yeah. Well done. All right. So with that, let's jump into the presentation, JD.
Yeah, I appreciate that. So we'll transition into that. Again, you know, that was fun. But by the way, that was also important to help you guys maybe get your mindset right into what we're going to talk about. And I know on your agenda it talks about yesterday, today, and tomorrow. We framed it up as the past, the current, and the future. And so, Clint, I'm going to kind of stay out of the way a little bit here because I really think it's important for you guys to understand where we've been, because we don't know where, we can't really know where we're going to go if we don't have an understanding where we've went. And so when Clint talks about this point of inflection that is upon us, it's big, and it's a shift. And so so we're going to talk a little bit about the past, the present, and the future of e-commerce.
Absolutely. So when we think about the past, I think probably a lot of people in this room have probably experienced this, where we looked at e-commerce and we said, wow, this is really interesting, and we all heard stories about people who were working two streets over, out of their garage, they were going into a store and buying stuff on markdown, they were, you know, the urban legend, they were making $500,000 a year working part-time, filling up FedEx trucks that pulled up to their garage. And it was super interesting and super fascinating. And we were trying to figure out, well, what does this mean, right? Is this thing going to stick? Is it going to become something in the future? And so as companies, we had a hard time getting our arms around it. We had a hard time getting our arms around it because, you know, it's challenging to think about, you know, well, how do we engage with them? We don't really understand that technology. It was a new thing. And so, you know, how do we tell the story? And why are these review things up there? And, you know, should we be willing to accept negative reviews? We had lots of questions about it, not very many answers. It was a small business, and so it was difficult in the normal sort of prioritization of strategies to get the kind of resources that we needed to engage. And then if that weren't enough, we were just overwhelmed by the supply chain. You mean we can't ship full truckload to 37 DCs? We're going to have to ship to actual human beings in different areas? And so it was very challenging for that reason. And so we kind of sat back as companies, and we looked at it, and we thought about, man, like, how is this going to develop for us? And so for my own self, a number of years ago, I had the opportunity to lead digital strategy to really start to understand, if e-commerce sticks, what would that mean for our company? What would that mean for our cold chain? What would that mean for our marketing teams? Well, how about product innovation? And what capabilities would we have to learn? And so that's what really brought me into this world probably about 10 years ago. So if we look at today, we've made a lot of progress as companies. The fact that we're all sitting here in this room as professionals in this space, we have made a lot of progress. We have, as companies, decided we're going to figure out how do we tackle it? What do we need to do? We've put resources in place. We started to hire the right kinds of people, bring technology forward to empower our organizations. As is usual, we're testing lots of different systems, and everybody is an inch wide and a mile deep with their solution. It requires us to figure it out. We like to call it death by a thousand cuts. We're all, in order to be selling and be able to market ourselves, we're paying 8 million people along the way, and that's just the way that it is until it starts to shake out and we really find where that value proposition is. And then all of those things, of course, drive to the point that we're struggling to figure out how do we make money at this. How do we do it efficiently? How do we find profitability? And as organizations, we've got to chase the growth. We can't walk away from that. But at the same time, we've got a responsibility to figure out how to make money doing it, right? And I think that's a big challenge for us as, you know, significant enterprises. Is that fair, JD?
Yeah, absolutely, Clint, for sure. Yeah, I think what, Jeff hit it on the head earlier in that, you know, companies are becoming technology-based. I know that when I attended the, and as many of you probably did, a couple years ago, a big supplier summit that Walmart had. I know for Clint and I, one of our takeaways was, wow, I mean, Walmart is talking the lingo now of really transforming the way they think and becoming a technology-based company. And that doesn't just mean, you know, leveraging a new app or whatever, but it's reimagining the supply chain distributions, how we move content and all that sort of stuff. So that really is a point in which now we see the line of sight. But where does this, where is this going to take us, though, Clint? I mean, where, tell me where this is going to go.
Absolutely. So when we look at the future, what we were really leading to in the beginning is that we think the next shift in e-commerce is, now that we've got our, you know, our arms around how do we deal with Amazon and how do we use third-party shippers, how do we leverage their DCs, how do we handle DSV, and we're kind of like, oh, gosh, this is great. We've got some stuff working. The next big move is going to be the is going to be moving to a global, transitioning to a global view on e-commerce. And this is where it gets really interesting, because it's really going to challenge a lot of conventions. Once again, it's going to challenge a lot of conventions that is organizations we have beliefs in and how things can operate. So as we think about this and we think how it's going to impact us, we got to think about the opportunity now that when we look at a product and we say, wow, this is our target consumer is 25% of the U.S. market or the North American market, and Guatemala is only going to be 5% of the population of Guatemala, which is already small. In the past, we would have punted on that. We would have said, wow, and you know, this is not something that we're going to push there. When we talk about e-commerce, that game changes. We can focus on that niche, and we can focus on it around the world. We can afford to go after that limited number of consumers. And so it becomes an and scenario, not an or scenario. And I think that's really the theme of this slide, is it really is about incrementality. Going back to that example in Guatemala, I can remember, you know, trying to open up some countries in Asia and the cost that was associated with it and the complexity to go to the market and understand that market, to, you know, find importers, to find our distributors, to buy the shelf space, to have our demos going on. All that activity with all that money that was being spent, and it created, again, an or scenario. I could do Thailand or I could do Indonesia. When we think about .com, we're not planting those flags. We don't have to do that in many cases. And so that really leads to point number three. There's a disruption in the supply chain model that as FMCG companies, we have to take note of. In the past, we would have been the ones building the infrastructure. We would have been the ones planting the flags. Amazon, Alibaba, Flipkart, the list goes on, are reimagining that supply chain. They are starting to build out that infrastructure. They are figuring out how to consolidate at a scale that we can't even begin to fathom. They're learning how to cross-dock in ports to efficiently move that product and drive consolidation. That network effect on the supply chain gives companies like that the ability to land product at a fraction of the cost for myself as a manufacturer in the past that I could have never gotten to. It's mind-blowing to me how efficient they're getting. So that's a big change that we've got to be thinking about. You might say, well, Clint, there's been a lot of fast growth going on across the world. And so, you know, is this going to continue to grow at the rate that we thought about? And so, you know, it's I don't think a secret that internet penetration is not as deep in certain countries as it is in the U.S. or in the Western world. And so while we have seen incredible fast growth, it also tends to be that the large population countries tend to be on the lower side of income and GDP. As the economics change, both for the shopper, but also for data and network connectivity and the cost of phones, we continue to see people piling into the market. That's going to drive growth in the e-commerce space internationally for a long, long time. So there's a lot of new e-shoppers that are going to be developed right across what we would think of as the developing world today. And lastly, of course, those shoppers will largely be interfacing and shopping off that thing that we probably all have in our back pocket or sitting on the table in front of us, that, you know, 3x5-inch screen. And so, you know, as we're thinking about content and connectivity and what stories we're putting out there, we've got to take that into account and make sure that we're mobile friendly. Because a lot of countries, it's just very simply, they only have that one screen. Does that make sense?
Yeah. So, Clint, when we talk about that e-commerce is the first globally scalable retail format, you know, there's probably some skeptics in the crowd saying, I don't know about that. I mean, we're in Walmart country. I mean, they, you know, they operate in a plethora of countries, or Carrefour, they've done it, or Aldi. And to some degree, varying degree, they have accomplished some of that. But even in those markets, right, they have different assortments. Maybe their pricing is different. And they may even operate with a different banner. So while we have seen this globally, retail, e-commerce, the big takeaway here is that this is the first truly scalable global retail format.
That's a great point, JD.
So what do we got to do? What do we need to be thinking about? You know, now we understand what's going on, the point of inflection. You articulated that really well. What are we going to do? How are we going to tackle this moving forward?
That's a great question.
You got some bullet points for us.
Thank goodness I'm prepared.
Good job.
So, first of all, we've got to acknowledge that Amazon and Baba and all these guys, they consider themselves a platform, right? They're taking on more and more of the role that we would have all done for ourselves in the past. We need to embrace that, and we need to mirror that. Just as we would as a sales team, how we would mirror our customers, we need to mirror a platform approach. That means we need to be showing them and demonstrating to them how we connect, that everything, in fact, is interrelated. Our selling to our content, that we've got automated order management software, and we're integrated with logistics and export opportunities. That's what's going to facilitate our success in the future. This leads to some ideas around some concepts, tools, practices that we as manufacturers, again, are going to want to start to incorporate, or at least begin to think about incorporating in a big way. So we all talk about the item file, right? It's a big thing, master data, SAP, the whole thing. And we are trying to link that up to content. We have got to start to really connect all of our specifications, what's the case pack size, what's the size of the packaging, et cetera. We've really got to start thinking about how do we link that up with some of the basic content stories so that it's all in one place. It doesn't require multiple different interactions across the system, and it's going to drive speed. Once we have that in place, we've got to think about, well, gosh, how do we get this everywhere? Like, how do we port this to Alibaba? How do we send this to Flipkart? How do we get this to Mercado Libre? Those are going to be challenges, and of course, there's a translation element to that. So as we think about that content, now we've got to think about that interconnectivity, right? And we've got to drive that. Now, obviously, our company, our brand for e-commerce is Ubiquity, and so this is why we named it. It means that we're going to have a lot more connection and a lot more interoperability with a much higher number of retailers, right? In the past, we as big companies, we would sort of limit and prioritize our biggest customers or who we want to be directly connected with, and we would leverage distributors for the rest. As we think about the future, we're looking at more and more direct connections to these portals. So I think, JD, if we look around the globe, 90% of e-commerce is done by 600,000 websites.
That's a big number, Clint.
In corporate America, thinking about being connected to those kind of numbers, you look like the jet guy on TV, right? So we believe that there's a huge need to be connected at light speed. The next thing is really two elements that are sort of the not sexy part of the business, but hugely important. And so we think about digital, global digital, as a channel, just as we would think about club or we would think about grocery. We try to think of it as a channel, and we need to have a team that's managing that because that content flows across borders much easier than products do, right? We can look it up. We can see it in many different places, so we need to have some consistency there. And so just like that, we also need to know how to process these orders. They all come in with different information. They've all got different, random sort of elements, and so that's why we've got to have a system that's going to be able to bring that in and allow us to process that efficiently. And then lastly, I think, JD, being integrated further downstream is going to be big. In certain markets, we can be integrated via API with companies like UPS or FedEx, where the moment that we create shipping, we're automatically machine talking to machine, building the shipment, automatic tracking, and flowing. But we've got to start thinking, how do we do that with an item being shipped out of Peoria, Illinois, that is ultimately headed to Ningbo, China, as an each. Right? It's going to get shipped to Chicago. It's going to move into an airlift station. It's going to get put up in the air. It's going to go across to customs. It's going to land, be imported. It's going to get on the ground, and it's going to be delivered to that shopper in Ningbo. Something approaching half of the market for cross-border trade in China is being done on an each's basis.
Today.
Today. So $10 or less, product, a product being shipped to China from the United States. It's crazy to think about how that can be done and how that can even make financial sense, but it's happening today. We're going to have those types of connections, I think, JD, to be able to manage that where there's no friction in the system. It's machines managing machines and doing all that communication, no?
Yeah, I agree. And so we think about a decade ago, we used to hear that software is eating the world, right? That's what we heard. And we have a philosophy that says APIs over the next decade are what's going to eat the world. That's how we're going to get the machines talking to machines. And so just something to get your mind around. So we'll bring up the kind of, when you walked into the room today, and we're about to close it down here, but when you walked into the room today, this was probably the vast majority of your viewpoint around e-commerce. And it was well-centered on Amazon for good reason. They've done a fantastic job, and we've seen some of the numbers to reflect that. The consumers are voting with their dollars. And, you know, there appeared to be a little bit of a fight, a little bit of a war happening, and there were some peripheral players out there. And so that's kind of, you know, the vision and where we were seeing e-commerce, probably most of you today coming in. But with what we were trying to lay out with this point of inflection and where we're going with e-commerce and how we got to be thinking. And by the way, this looks very complex, and it is. Clint spoke to a lot of that complexity. But it also represents a lot of opportunity, a lot of opportunity. So, Clint, you want to speak to, like, think about the various markets and how we would tackle these, right? I mean, you've got, this is Clint's baby here. This took him a long time to do. He literally had to draw in all the little, you know, colors. But
this is the premise of our company. Yeah. So, you know, as you think about that global map, you really start to think, wow, man, this is pretty interesting. This really looks cool. And you also start to recognize lots of different names on here. And these are only the top couple of websites in a given region. This is not really getting deep. This doesn't explore the different mechanisms for those websites, getting down to the detail. And so you look at this and you say, wow, you know, where are the big countries? Well, those are in green. Those are your top GMV markets today. You then take a step down and you look at the gold countries and you say, well, those are the high growth countries today. Now, by the way, I will tell you, I missed one. I didn't get Indonesia highlighted, which is 2017's fastest growing e-shopper community, so apologize for that. But you get the point here that it's spread all around, right? It's not a regional thing. It's not Latin America, and you're not going to go build an outpost in Latin America, or you could, but to really tackle this, you've got to think as a network, your company as a network around the world. And that's really what we're really trying to drive home. And so that's gonna be driven by, you know, making some strategic decisions about resources, about what kind of systems that you're gonna invest in, and how you're gonna engage around the world. Yep. So, appreciate your all's time today. I don't know, are we doing questions, Jeff?
How are we on time?
We're good.
We're good? Okay.
Yeah. At Ubiquity, we're all about providing these connections. Today, we're connected to well over 60 retailers where we can transact business. It's all digital and machine to machine. And so that's really the concept of what we've been building, really for our own business, and folks started asking us to use it. So at any rate, we're going to be around for, you know, throughout the day. So if anybody's got any questions or wants to talk, feel free to, or challenges, please feel free to come and see us. And I guess, Jeff, happy to take questions if there's any.
Yeah,
nailed it.
Right.
All right. Thanks, guys. Really appreciate
it. Thank you.